Hi everyone, welcome to the WSU User Group Meetup in Bangalore. I'm Sam from WSU2 and I will be your moderator for today. First of all, I would like to thank each and every one of you for joining us today despite what's happening in the world. And because of the ongoing situation, we are conducting this meetup online, but we do want a lot of interaction and we want you to be as involved as possible in the conversation. So during the session, there is a Q&A tab in the Zoom panel at the bottom of the Zoom window, where you can send in questions whenever you want during the session. There's also a chat tab where you can chat with the other attendees or panelists and things like that. You can either send a message to everyone or send personal messages as well. After you ask questions, we will answer either in the Q&A tab itself. So we'll type out the answer and answer it, or we will answer it live at the end of the session. And depending on whether we have time left, we may even let everyone unmute themselves and kind of have an open discussion with our panelists and the other attendees. Also, I would like to mention that this is recorded and we will send you the recording and the slides to everyone who registered for the meetup. Let's get into some intros now. So this meetup is presented by WSU2 and LTI. WSU2 is an open source technology provider that offers an API-first and decentralized approach to help developers and architects build digital products. LTI is a global technology consulting and digital solutions company, helping more than 400 clients succeed in a converging world. LTI is also actually WSO2's global system integrator partner, and they were WSO2's top partner of the year in Asia Pacific region in 2020. Today we will be speaking about building an integration agile digital ecosystem. And our first speaker is Rohit Alinagama, who is based in Colombo, Sri Lanka. He's a director of solutions architecture at WSO2 and has worked on many digital transformation projects for APAC WSO2 customers. We also have Anandya Pramanik, who is based in Pune, India. He is a senior specialist WSO2 application architect at LTI Digital Integration. And he currently handles digital transformation delivery and consulting with a focus on WSO2. Thank you so much, Rohita and Anandya, for being here. We really appreciate you sharing your knowledge with us. That is it from me. Over to you, Rohita.
Thanks, Sam. Guys, let's get started. Let's talk about today's agenda. So today we are going to talk about first little bit of brownfield versus greenfield integration. And wait, I mute my mobile phone as well. Some background noise. Okay. Today first we are going to talk about brownfield versus greenfield integration. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about WSO2 Enterprise Integrator. And then after, we are planning to do a set of demonstration for you by considering the system like is integrated with standard protocol with API and all, and also non-standard protocol like SDK and all, and also file-based integration, how you configure file-based integration, and also how to do integration with databases, what are techniques available for database-to-database integration, and also in terms of integration, how you provide the guaranteed delivery for your messages. And at the end, I'm going to show you some Kubernetes cluster deployment with WSO2 AI with a complete CI/CD flow. So that's our plan. So first, let's start with initial steps. So I'm going to start with this slide. I think you guys may see this slide before as well. So this is an important Gartner observation. What it says is, integration work will account for 50% of your time and cost of building digital platform. If you are planning to build a digital platform for your organization, 50% of your time and cost you have to invest for an integration. Then you have to decide what's the best integration platform for you to play with that 50% of time and cost in efficient manner. Today, we are going to talk about the approaches you can take, techniques you can take to achieve that goal. So before talk about integration, I would like to talk about the what is the brownfield and greenfield greenfield, and also integration point of view. What is brownfield integration? What is greenfield integration? So first, so what is brownfield? Brownfield in agricultural terms, in the as a land, it is a land you use for different purposes early. You may be cultivate, you may be the construction, and you have to use that land for your whatever the current requirement. So in other words, greenfield means you have fresh land and you can use that fresh land for your current objective. And when we talk about integration, similarly, the greenfield integration means you develop the infrastructure what you need with latest technologies. You use microservice architecture, you do cloud native deployment, you are with full APIs, and then you do your digital transformation journey. In other words, brownfield integration means you use your existing infrastructure, existing legacy system, existing integration, and do your digital transformation journey. If you are a developer, sometime you may like to do greenfield integration, because you can use all the services, you can redevelop it, and you keep all microservice manner, you can deploy in the cloud or support it. But if you are a manager or CIO in your organization, I'm sure you like to do a brownfield integration. Reason is challenges you face day to day, because you can't develop the entire system. You have to use whatever the mature system as it is, but you have to do your digital transformation journey in very smooth manner. So today we are going to talk about how to do a brownfield integration, how to use your existing system as it is and do integration journey, the digital transformation journey for your organization. So let's think why brownfield integration is very important for your day-to-day business. Definitely, it reuses your existing systems. And also, it will cut down the time it takes for digital transformation. Very important. And also, it will cut down the cost you have to invest for your digital transformation. And also, there's another scenario. Not all existing systems are replaceable. Let's say you have in your organization, it's a very legacy system that's run perfectly fine with 10 years. It is very critical for your businesses. But system point of view, it is legacy system. So no documentation, even no one know what happened for entire system. Maybe a two or three developers work with those system, and like no one willing to take the responsibility of transfer that with latest technology, very challengeable. So that type of situation, you have to live with this system. You have to live with this system for another 4 to 5 years. Then in case of brownfield integration, what we are talking is you use that system as it is, but provide the proper the digital transformation for your customers and partners. So those are the challenges, especially people involved for costing, people take the decision, is still willing to do a brownfield integration. So what are the type of brownfield systems in your organization? So sometimes you may have system based on standard protocols. So very easy, they maybe have REST or SOAP API layer and you do an integration. It's a very fundamental thing. And then you have some other system with non-standard or proprietary protocols. So for example, let's assume SAP type of system. So SAP type of system in the initial version, you have to use their SDKs for integration. You have to use that SDK and do the communication and do integration, and then you do your digital transformation. So then we are going to talk about how to use that type of SDKs. And also there are some other systems that support for file-based integration. So security point of view is not the recommended way, but is still in the world, file-based integrations are running. So in case of file-based integration, best example, the Oracle, SAP, even PeopleSoft. So those will support to schedule the file to particular pod. So automatically you can create the data in a particular pod. Then enterprise integration system pick the file from pod and trigger integration and do the task. So that type of techniques also people use these days. And also there are some other system that don't provide any integration pod. No API, no SDK, no even file-based integration. What they support is database to database integration. So as if you are security guy, you know challenges to opening database integration and opening ports, provide the credential for third party system, maybe out of your network. So those are the challenges. So today let's talk about all these scenario and how to tackle those challenges by selecting proper integration platform. So what are the key functional requirement in your integration? You have to do a transformation. You have to do a routing. You have to do the orchestration. You have to do sometime protocol switching. Sometime you have to do the parallel processing. So this will cover like almost 70 to 80% of your integration challenges, but those are very common challenges for any organization. Let's see what it is. So when we talk about transformation, so let's assume you have your existing system. It is brownfield and you are developing new integration layer. And then you have to provide the proper integration for your client. So for example, let's assume this brownfield system support only SOAP APIs, but your clients expect the REST API layer. Then you have to do a little transformation between SOAP to REST. And also let's assume the JSON to XML transformation. So like a different transformation, message transformation, or sometime you have to hide some field in your existing system. Or you have to add some field, you have to put some encryption. So different transformation challenges are there in day to day. So then different routing challenges. So for example, let's assume you are getting some messages and then you have to read some message property or maybe a message body or URL or something. And then you have to route message into different system. In this example, whatever green color messages system A, the red color messaging system B, and then do your integration. It is routing requirement. And next, orchestration. So let's assume you are getting the message and then you have to call to system A, get some response, and then build some different payload to call system B, get the response, and then you have to remember some of the output received from system A or system B, create completely new payload for system C and call that system and get the response, finally response back to caller. So this orchestration. And also protocol switching. Let's assume behind the scene you have some message brokering solution. So let's assume that message brokering solution support a JMS protocol, but you can't export JMS as it is for end users. Then you have to do some protocol switching from HTTP to JMS. You are getting some HTTP REST type API input, and then you transfer it to JMS, then communicate with the message broker. So even some demonstration, I'm going to show how this type of system will work. This is protocol switching. And next, you have to do the parallel processing. For example, let's assume you are getting the message, and then you have to pass that message in a synchronous manner to system A and system B, and then you have to collect the responses, and then you have to do whatever your remaining task. It is parallel process. So those are the challenges you will face in day to day in your integration requirement. So now let's talk about little bit about WSO2 Enterprise Integrator and talk about how WSO2 Enterprise Integrator will help for those challenges. So what is WSO2 Enterprise Integrator? I think you all know. It is fully open source solution and you can use it freely if you are very familiar. And also it is a cloud native distribute hybrid integration platform for integrating your APIs and data using microservice cloud native architecture or centralized ESP style architecture. When we talk about integration, so very beginning people talk about ESB centralized architecture. Even WSO2, where our initial version was ESB. It is centralized ESB layer and do a integration. But now people want to do a decentralized architecture like this. So it is microservice driven and it is cloud native support. So in that case, you can even deploy WSO2 Enterprise Integrator in a decentralized architecture like that, and it will communicate to integration point or integration point to your backend services. So this is a decentralized architecture of integration. So WSO2 Enterprise Integrator support for both techniques. So I'm going to show you a demonstration how this centralized will work and also how you automate this decentralized deployment with CI/CD driven deployment. Okay. So how this integration actually will work? Let's assume you have different business application, partner systems, some APIs, some web services, and also some messaging system as well. And also some situation you have to work with file system, file-based integration. And also on the other hand, you have an enterprise application like SAP, Oracle, PeopleSoft, whatever. And also on the other hand, you have a set of database integration. So what WSO2 Enterprise Integrator do is put that in the middle and do this anything to anything integration as a middleman. And deployment may be centralized or decentralized. Let's talk in different context, but it is anything to anything integration layer with this type of challenges. Okay. Now let's talk about how enterprise integrators support for those challenges. Sorry, I want to bring my mouse point. Okay, support for those challenges. So when we talk about typical integration flow, you have a incoming message, then you are getting some incoming payload. Then you have to play with that payload. You have to split that payload, or you have to call different service and get the some response and enrich that payload, or you have to call two different system and aggregate the payload, or you have to log the payload. So those are the things you are doing with your payload. So in WSO2 terms, we have provided the concept called mediators. Mediators is a different built-in block to do those operations. Then you connect those mediators together and you play with the message. You can do that for your in sequence, your out sequence, or if any error occur, some preventive action. So WSO2 point of view, we have provided set of mediators for you guys to do those tasks. And graphical in low code environment, drag and drop manner, you can connect those mediators. So that's the WSO2 story. And what those mediators? When talk about WSO2, we have like a 56 mediators. These are samples. And say example, send or call out mediator. If you want to call different API and get the response, you can use those mediators. And switch mediator. Switch mediator is something like your programming switch case. But difference is programming switch case, you will write the source code, on Java or .NET or whatever, you write the code. But in a WSO2 world, you can use switch mediator. You no need to write the code. You can configure it in a UI in a graphical manner, and you can play with the message. You can evaluate message content, message body, or some information, and you can switch the message to different system. Those are different mediators. So we have 56 mediators. We will show those mediators in our demonstration. And also to connect those mediators, we have provided the environment called WSO2 Integration Studio. So Integration Studio works like this. It's drag and drop manner. Those mediators you can drag and drop, and you can connect those and build your integration flow. The advantage is even less. Assume programmer, they can do the integration, but it's a source code manner. But here it is drag and drop manner. The advantage is, so manager or CIO or some even non-technical people, I'm not saying non-technical, they are technical, but they are not a programmers. Now they are not doing programming, they are managers. But they can understand those integration logic very well. That's the importance of WSO2 Enterprise Integrator. So you can see visually what happened and you can do. And also this enterprise integrator support for debugging, support for mediation flows. You can put the breakpoint and you can debug your integration. This is actually Eclipse Place Eclipse plugin. And also it support for package your integration and deploy into your environment. So in terms of deployment, if it is a VM or if it's a bare metal, then package it and move to some folder. But now when it is Kubernetes or it is containerized situation, using Enterprise Integrator, even you can build your Docker container, customized Docker container and deploy, or Kubernetes artifacts and deploy. So those cases, how it works is, it will pick the base product image and then it will integrate whatever the integration into that image, and then it will create the customized Docker image for your integration requirement. And then using some CI/CD flow, you can automate that deployment. Even today at the end, we are going to show some demonstration on that line. So so now let's talk about how WSO2 is support for this type of brownfield integration challenges using WSO2 Enterprise Integrator. So again, I'm going to talk about these challenges with WSO2 terms. So first, let's talk about transformation. You want to do the message transformation. For you to do the message transformation, you have different mediators. So first mediator is a data mapper. Data mapper mediator, you can map your input and output. You can bring the XML object here and JSON object here, and then you can map to field by field in graphical manner, like what you did in Access databases. You remember Access databases, very old days when you are studying UIT, Access databases, you can, even right now you are using that, you connect field to field. Like similar way, you can use data map and connect those sister message formats and then do the transformation. And some situation you can enrich your messages. Some situation you can use payload factory to create completely new message. Or some situation even you can use XSLT type mediators to transform message from text file to text format to XML format. So that type of transformation. I'm going to show even file processing scenario, how to read the file and then transform it to XML and do some operation. So you have different mediators to do a transformation. Then you can use Integration Studio, connect those mediators and do your job. And next, the transformation, this is a data mapper. So this is input object, this is output object, drag and drop panel, you can connect those, or you can use some built-in blocks, so uppercase, lowercase, or some arithmetic operation to data and do it and do transformation. This fully visually driven. So it is a transformation. Then next, routing. So routing, basically you can use mediators like switch mediator, this example. So you can read the message and then you can route to system A and B. And or you, some situation you can use filter mediators. So you can connect those mediators and do the routing task. So in demonstration, we'll show those things, how it works. And then orchestration. Orchestration, you call system A, B and C in this sequential manner, or sometime it is a asynchronous manner. So then it's become a parallel process. So you can use mediator like call mediator and all to do that type of task. And also protocol switching. So best example is HTTP to JMS. So you can use WSO2 Enterprise Integrator and transform your HTTP object to JMS and then transfer it to a message broker. And also you can use WSO2 Enterprise Integrator to connect with message broker, read the message and take some action to a message. So that's all about WSO2 Enterprise Integrator support for these techniques. Now this point upwards till end, we are planning so many demonstration scenario. So when I talk about those demonstration scenario, we are planning 5 demonstration scenario. First, integrated system that talk with standard protocol and also integrated with database system and what are solution available for database to database integration. And also next, I am going to talk about integration with file-based system and then how to ensure guaranteed delivery and then the Kubernetes cluster type CI/CD deployment of sub integration. So first 2 scenario going to handle by Anindan team from LTI. So this point upwards, I would like to hand over to LTI team to conduct two demo scenario, and then after I'm planning to cover other three remaining scenario. And then team, it's over to you. Please start your part.
Hi, Rohita. Thank you so much for providing me the opportunity. I hope I'm audible clearly.
Yes, you can.
Okay.
Yes, we can.
Okay. So we shall start. I'll just share my screen. Just a minute.
Sure. Thanks.
Okay. So we shall start. So today we would go through some demos for a few use cases which Rohita was explaining. Of them, the agenda would be for me. I would be showing you routing, data transformation, orchestrations, and data service using WSO2 EI. So I just wanted to run through the scenarios in a presentation mode, and then probably we'll go into the coding section, how we do it. So where channel systems like mobile apps, web apps come and interact with the WSO2's API gateway. And from there, we go into WSO2 EI for routing, data transformation, orchestrations, and data service. Yes. And then we can go into the backend systems. And we have put down some backend system based on what we work on currently. So from a routing perspective, okay, based on some query parameters or some parameters from a request, we route to various backends or various switches or those kind of routings are handled efficiently in WSO2 EI, and we use switch case mediator, and then we use request action based cases, and we do the final routing based on these parameters. Okay. From our data transformation, we use data mapper, or we use so for one to many mapping, we pass one value to different fields. You have other options also available, like passing constants and conditional field mappings. These kind of things can be easily done using WSO2 EI. Going forward, we can use iterator mediator inside WSO2 EI and the aggregate mediator to do various kinds of orchestrations that may be required, which Rohita was explaining briefly. So let's suppose we take an example of a bank where you have three, four different systems where we as a customer, we hold two or three different products of the bank. So let's suppose the savings bank product, which you hold, remains in one of the backends. Okay, the loan accounts are held in a separate backend system, and the credit card that you might hold from the bank is held at a different system. So to see all these things together, okay, these systems might have come in at a very at a different point in time in the bank itself. And the main problem or the main challenge for the bank would be to handle the customer IDs of us, to be managed across all these systems, because all these systems work differently in a disjoint manner in a completely different format, to be very precise. And, when you want to tie these things up, what happens is you would probably see a MDM system coming into the picture, okay, where a parent customer ID is stored, and then with that parent customer ID, all the other customer IDs are mapped, the system customer IDs are mapped. Okay, so when you log into your internet banking, if the bank chooses to show you all the accounts in one go, then at the back end, the bank would make, or we would make one call to the MDM system. And then from the response of that particular MDM system, we will get back all the customer IDs that, you know, we have in different systems. And we go accordingly to into those systems to get back those responses. So here, this is a a classic case of orchestration use case, where we actually take a response from one system, and based on that response, we create a request for the other systems. And then we fan it out, we get it back, and then we use aggregator mediator to aggregate all your responses and show all your account holdings in the bank in one screen. Yes, so that is a very simple case of orchestration and aggregation, which we took. And this is the data service diagram, where we have an API which is exposed. That API would finally expose a data service, which the data service in EI would connect to a database and give back the response or give back the data set in a JSON format. So we will quickly go into the code section, and we see what exactly we might have. I hope we can see the screen now, the workspace. Sam, can you see?
Yeah, we can see it.
Okay, thank you. So this is an example. I'll just blow it up a bit so that it is a bit more visible. So this is an example flow of the orchestration use case and the switch use case that we were talking about. Okay, so this is the API layer, which gets exposed to the external world. Then we, set a bunch of properties, right? So when we get a request, okay, so I just wanted to show you the properties of the switch case. Yes, so in this case, so this is content-based routing, right? So in this case, what we see is we pick up something from the header parameters, okay? And in the header parameters, we get either comments due soon, or posted recently, or recently submitted. These are the regular expressions that we have defined for branching it out, right? And when we have this case, like comments updated, we go ahead and call a separate URL over here, as you can see. Okay, so this is comments due soon endpoint. And when we get this particular, value in the request, we actually go in and call this particular case, okay? And when we call this particular case, we go ahead, we form the URI or the request message from whatever we have got from the original request. Okay, there is a cert spec, there is a start row number, and these kind of things that we pass on to the backend system. Over here, it is a Siebel system that we are talking about. Okay, and then we get back a response. Okay, similarly, for when it is posted recently, when the use case name is posted recently, it gets routed to this particular endpoint. Okay. When it is a display recently submitted, it is this particular endpoint. And if somebody sends out nothing, then it goes into the default. Okay. Once we get filter node for you. Okay. So we check whether it's a so if it is an error, okay, we get it over here. Or else, if it is a success, we say that, you know, what is the exact message. Okay, so over here we say that, you know, this is the message, this is the error message, and we respond to it. Okay, and if it is a success message, we go ahead and we see how many records are there, and hence we use a for each node over here. Okay, and based on some expression which we can see over here, we iterate through the entire message. Okay, and then we do a switch case over here as well. Okay, so this is all setting a bunch of properties in case of where we want to go ahead and do this entire, you know, when there is a next set available in this particular message, it goes in and reads it. And finally, we do a data mapping using the implicit data mapper, the GUI. Okay, over here it's a drag and drop mapping. Once we do this data mapping, the backend format gets transformed into the format of the consumer, and we send this message back. Once we are done with the data mapping, we send this message back to the front-end consumer, whoever has called us. So over here, we saw use cases. I'll just go back to the PowerPoint presentation. Okay, over here, we saw data transformation. We saw routing, okay, using switch case mediators. We saw request action-based cases, okay? And we saw the data transformation, right? We had one more thing left to show. That was the data service, which we spoke about. So in the data service, when we get a request, in the API, we normally get the parameters which the query would be based upon, right? So when we see this particular flow over here, there is a data service that we have created called as name. Profession name list or profession list, to be very frank. So in this particular data service, we can see that we have created, we have right template, and we are going and hitting the database based on these two parameters. Okay, so I'll just and then once we get the response of that particular database call, we go ahead and we change that particular database data into a payload into a JSON format based on this particular criteria that we have defined. Okay, so we'll just quickly show.
Hi.
Sorry. Can you see my screen now?
Yes. Yeah, I can see.
So we saw, the various use cases. Yes. So over here, if you notice, so we say that, recently submitted, Okay, and we give a date range. We give a user ID. We give a start phone number, and we send out that particular use case where we have this thing running. We have this flow running somewhere in our own network. Okay, so when we send this out, we see that there is no data for the requested resource. So over here, it is a data. A data issue, and hence we are giving out an error. Okay, so this goes into the use case where the error use case was explained. Okay, so when we go to the next scenario, right, this is comments due soon, if you can see on the screen. Okay, if we send this, okay, we get the data back from the backend in a JSON format over here, and it gives you a bunch of sections where which defines the data set which we had in the backend system. Okay, similarly for posted recently, we'll send it out and we see that there are a bunch of different systems, different sets of data, which we can fetch from the backend based on the routing criteria that we have provided over here in the request section. Okay, and this finally is the data service, which says MCA profession over here. Okay, and I'll just run this out, and if you see, we could fetch the data successfully. Okay, there is no error, and we could fetch the data successfully, and the data is mapped in a JSON format, using name as the key and the actual name, actual names, or this is the profession list that is stored in the database, and this gets rendered on the screen probably as a drop down. Okay, so all these things, what is the profession of that particular person would be selectable from a drop down in the front end. Okay, and with this, I will hand it over back to Rohita.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you so much.
Yes, please stop share your desktop and I'll share my desktop. Okay. Okay, then you see how we did with the first two demonstration scenario, and I am going to move into a third demonstration scenario. That's mainly talk about integration with pile-based system. For me to build that integration with pile-based scenario, so there are still plenty of requirement for you to do a pile-based integration. So when we talk about WSO2 Enterprise Integrator, it supports wide range of file transferring protocol, FTP, SFTP, FTPS, or SMB, likewise different protocols. So anyway, you can listen to particular folder and process it, or listen to particular folder and you can get the data and output that as a service as well. Both will support it. So to cover my third demonstration scenario, I would like to explain little integration requirement. Let's assume in your country, so you are going to develop some e-channeling or channeling services. So in case of channeling services, this is the API you are going to expose to your partners or channeling engines to make the channeling booking. So when that request comes, first what they need to do is you have to route that request to particular hospital. So then get booking part done. Once booking part done, then we have to do depend on loyalty program and all, then you have to do some discount calculation for those booking. And at the end, you have to work with some payment engine to get the auto payment settled. So let's consider a hypothetical scenario like that. So in this situation, I have used the mediators like data mapper, property, payload factory, call or log mediator. So that's the basic thing I have developed using Enterprise Integrator. I'll show that. But my scenario is not that. So let's assume any channel collection center, any partners, if they can make the API call, then they can get this booking done. But let's assume there is a channel collection center in some location. They have legacy system to enter whatever channel information, but they are not willing to change that system to directly integrate with API layer. Then what to do? Let's assume that system support to dump some file into a particular folder. Then you can you can configure WSO to EI to listen that folder as SFTP or like FTP type of way, listen to that folder and process that whatever the file receive and identify record and then trigger this integration. So it is my scenario. So before show that scenario, I would like to show my integration environment. So this is again WSO2 Enterprise Integrator is running in my environment. And my LTKI colleagues aren't in the show most of the cases, but I want to show one more scenario regarding deployment. So in case of deployment, so WSO2 Enterprise Integrator support different deployment techniques. So you can create the composite application and you can deploy into a VMO bare metal environment. Or you can export the project and run here and you can put the breakpoint and all option available. Or else you can generate the Docker images for your environment. Even at the end, I'm going to show how you create the Docker image. And then you can use that Docker image for your deployment. Or you can generate the Kubernetes artifacts and then deploy into your Kubernetes environment. Actually, my last demo is based on this Kubernetes deployment with CI/CD. I'll do at the end. So those are the options available for deployment. So in this, my demonstration scenario, let's assume I use data mapper to do that some transformation for my input. Then I am going to use switch mediator to switch into a different hospital, depend on payload. Once that switching part is completed, then I'll calculate some discount calculation API, maybe from the same provider. And then I'm going to call the payment service. So payment service, you can see I have developed as a sequence. I'll explain the reason for later. But this is my basic integration flow. So I'll use in my Postman, this is a pull flow. And I am sending the basic information, patient name, and who is the doctor, what is the hospital, card number, appointment date, and all. So I'll generate that payload, and then I am getting the booking confirmation. So system point of view, you can see Enterprise Integrator is running, and wait, I'll generate another payload and show you how it works. And you can see the Enterprise Integrator debug window, it create the message. Route into Grand Duck Hospital, and also my payment service. You can see payment service, you are getting the message payment received. So that's how a basic API is developed. But my demonstration scenario is not the basic API, how to listen to particular folder. So for that, I have a create endpoint called file processing endpoint. So this file processing endpoint basically listen to a particular folder, and then I'll show from source code view. It is listen to particular folder. It's here in my desktop input folder, and I can configure file format, file protocol, and all, and process this file. Then pick this file from folder. Then after, what it'll do is it'll trigger file processing sequence. So let's see what this file processing sequence. So file processing sequence, what it will do is it use Smooks Mediator. You remember I talked about Smooks Mediator. What Smooks Mediator will do is transform that text content and create the output that's as a XML output. And then you use iterate mediator. It's like a for loop. So loop against each element in the XML object and then call our actual API. So the payment API is calling. So now all are set up. Now let's see how it works. And you please note the thing. So when integration trigger, you should get the messages here. It is running and payment service, you should get the message payment received. So So that's how you have to see. Now let's go to my Pi. So this is sample Pi. I have four recorders. This is a CSV format. And that's here clearly you can see what is the hospital, two record per Grand Oak, two record per Fine Valley and credit card and some four records just generated from that legacy system. Now go to a system and let's assume I'll go to some source folder and I'll bring this file and then I'll copy this file manually to input folder. But normal way it should generate from that legacy system. So I'll paste this file into my input folder. Yeah, you can see it was there and now it vanished. So that means it processed. So here you can see some logs. Here you can see four new logs generated. It is, you can see routing to Grand Oak Hospital two record and Pine Valley two record. That means my process pick can process in the platform. And also you can, when you go to here, you can see four record of payment confirmation. So that means altogether it picked the file and then transform that to XML, run the loop and call the API. So that type of small development you can do using this type of development in drag and drop manner. So you can see it's a log media. If you log some message, you can just drag and drop here. You can see. And behind the scene, it will generate the source code. This is a synapse, what we in our language synapse. So this is synapse code. But you know, you should not, no need to do a synapse, no need to know the synapse language. You can use designer and you can do what you need. So that's the beauty in this type of agile integration platforms. So now let's go into my presentation and I have to cover some more scenarios. So this is my first demo scenario, how to trigger integration from file and then process file input to weigh the and create some XML object and create some JSON object and then trigger a normal integration. So this is my first scenario. So similar way. So let's assume you want to share the file generated in legacy system with your clients or partners. So best example, you know, system like SAP, Oracle and all, you can automate like file to particular folder. But normal integration scenario, what you have to do is you have to get that file and then you have to send it manually or email or something for integration or some data exchange requirement. But using WSO2 Enterprise Integrator, what you can do is connect to this file and then after you can expose the data available in this file as a HTTP REST or SOAP web service. Then behind the scene, it will generate the SOAP or REST service using WSO2 Enterprise Integrator and it will expose data to outside world. It is the one other way. And this connector may be a file, may be a database, in that case relational database or non-relational database or some situation that may be a Google Doc, Google Excel sheet, not Excel, Google Sheets. So you can connect to those sheets and you can expose that service. Then always this legacy system generate file to particular folder and you can listen. Then when someone made the request, read whatever the latest file level in the folder and expose those data as a service. That's why I say you can use your whatever the brownfield system as it is and you can provide the best REST or SOAP whatever API layer to in your digital transformation. You don't need to change whatever your underlying infrastructure. You can keep that as it is. So that's our objective. Okay, then let's talk about non-standard, some system with non-standard or proprietary protocol. That's the best example is SAP. SAP, they have SDKs. So for how WSO support for that type of integration. For that, what WSO2 provide is, WSO2 Enterprise Integrator, we have provided the concept called connectors. So that connectors embedded the SDK and then communicate with non-standard or proprietary protocol system. And for users, it provides the HTTP APIs. Let's assume earlier SAP case, now they have REST API layer. If you want to provide some API from SAP system, you can use these connectors and provide the nice API layer for your end customers or end partners. That's the beauty. And also we have like a 230 connectors in WSO2. And those connectors, other thing is those connectors also free of charge. You can get the open source product and you can download the connector. You can use connector and you can do an integration. So we have like 230 connectors. I'll share this thing. And this is the URL and you can search in the Google WSO2 connector store. Then it will go to connect. You can see the what available connectors. So connectors like SAP Oracle, PeopleSoft, and Salesforce and all those connectors. So you can use those connectors for your integration requirements. So, and also I'm going to show how you connect. I'm not going to show any demonstration on connectors, but I am going to show some sample situation. Let's assume Salesforce REST. So if you want to connect a connector for your integration project, you can click next and then it will load the available. It will take some time. Sorry about that. Maybe it does depend on my connectivity. Yeah, you can see the different connectors. These connectors actually comes from our connector store. Let's assume if you want to integrate with SAP, you can type SAP and you can search it. And then, yeah, you can see SAP connector. You can use this connector and do the integration. So that's how the connector story will work. Okay. Now I would like to move into my next demonstration scenario. My next demonstration scenario is how to ensure the guaranteed delivery. So you know this type of in this type of integration scenario, those APIs from different vendors, you are not sure about availability of these APIs. So those API maybe come from different service providers, different vendors. So that type of integration guaranteed delivery is a very important scenario on this integration. So in case of WSO2, we support to integrate with any message brokering solution. So in the demonstration, what I'm trying to do is I assume my payment service may be shut down or not available sometime. In that situation, what I try to do is my whatever the channel booking message, I'm going to transfer into message broker. And then I have developed a simple message listener. So message listener will check the availability of payment service. If that available, pick the message from message broker and deliver to endpoint. So this will handle the guaranteed delivery scenario. Here it is, I have put here, but depending on your business requirement or even for entire flow, you can configure message brokering solution or some parts you can configure. You have to take different action depend on, because you can't put the whole for entire integration, but depend on situation and depend on the your availability requirement, you can put the message broker in different situation. So WSO2 will provide the connectivity for ActiveMQ, RabbitMQ, even Kafka. So different message brokers to provide that guaranteed delivery. So in this demonstration, I'm going to show how I have configured it. So I'll go to my enterprise integration environment. So here, you remember I talk about my payment service I have developed as a sequence. So reason I process this as a sequence is, in this sequence, what I have done is I have just called in the payment endpoint. But if any error occur, you can see on error, send to store sequence. So I have configured send to store sequence. Now let's see what I have done in the send to store sequence. Okay, give me 1 minute. Yeah, send to store, where it is, sequence. Yeah, this is my send to store sequence. So here I am using store mediator. So store mediator is other word, it is the connectivity for message brokering solution. So I am using store mediator and then I am create the payload, sample payload. Say, sorry, payment service not respond in this stage and booking confirmation will receive an email. So I put some distributed situation and I am booking is confirmed, but payment is not done. That means entire flow is not completed. So in that situation, I pass the message like this and then I have configured payment message store and then message processor. So this is message processor. So what this message processor will do is listen to message queue and check the endpoint availability. If that's available, message will deliver. Otherwise, it will not happen. Now let's see how it works. So normal situation, if I trigger an integration flow, you can see you are getting the booking confirmation. But now what I'm trying to do is I'll shut down my payment service. I have shut down my payment service. Now payment service is not available. Now what I'm trying to do is I'm going to trigger this integration again. Now, since payment service is not available, it says, sorry, the payment service is not responding. So booking confirmation will receive via email. That means now that this message will move to the message brokering solution. So here I am using the ActiveMQ message queue. So you can see there's a one message pending in the queue. So this is the my message queue, one message pending in the queue. So now I'll go to again to my backend service. And now EI is trying to connect into backend, but backend is not available. So now I'll start my backend service. So once this available, this my message should have to be delivered into a payment service and should have to complete the flow. Till this is started, you can see I have used some Ballerina type of command. So Ballerina is a WSO2 own programming language. So that programming language mainly focus the integration support, like 2 or 3 code line, you can do some integration. So using Ballerina, I have developed this service. That's why I start this as Ballerina. And also WSO2 future, even now you can see WSO2 cloud platform releases and also new product releases, all those use WSO2 Ballerina language. So Ballerina now is service started, but it's still maybe trying this message brokering solution to deliver it. And here now you can see payment receive message. That means message deliver since the backend is up. And you can see message deliver. And now if I check my message brokering solution, there was a one message in the pending queue. Now if I refresh my queue, see what happened. You can see no pending message because system is available, it delivered it and all now dequeued. So that's how you configure a guaranteed delivery situation. So till now my all local deployed integration requirements are over. Now I want to move to that Kubernetes and CI/CD driven deployment. So I'll stop my local environment. And now, I want to put some point because this will not provide the entire guaranteed delivery. So depending on situation, you have to plug your message broker. But WSO2 Enterprise Integrator support, like without any coding, to communicate with standard message brokers. So I am going to move into my final demonstration. And also, if you guys have any question, please type that on Q&A section, and we are ready to answer any problems. Actually, we'll answer those questions. And also, now I am going to move into my final demonstration. This is a little CI/CD flow, and I need some network bandwidth as well. So since I am working from home, I'm not sure that my internet connectivity and success of this whole demo, but I can show you how it works. So when I talk about WSO2 Enterprise Integrator, I talk about WSO2 EI deployment pattern. So first is ESP style centralized. Second one is microservice driven decentralized architecture. So distributed architecture, not decentralized, distributed architecture. So in case of distributed architecture, you have different microservices. So those different microservices may be called different backend microservices, so some message broker, event broker, and microservice to microservice. So you end up with n number of microservices. Then we talk about deployment. Is it practical for deploy you one by one? In the VM or like some administrator check the health check and all, it's not practical. No, that situation people use mainly a Kubernetes type of environment, and also people automate that deployment from your enterprise integration environment to your Kubernetes environment. So that's we call a CI/CD driven fully automated deployment, because these things are, it's little difficult to maintain like manual. So it should, we should have used some CI/CD flow in the distributed architecture. So my next demonstration, what I'm trying to do is, I am trying to deploy some integration development, and I am going to use the Jenkins. So Jenkins, what I'm trying to do is, I develop some integration, and then I am going to write some unit test cases. And then Jenkins server, what I'm trying to do is, I'll first ask Jenkins server to run the unit test. And if unit tests are succeeded, then I'll ask Jenkins servers to create some customized Docker images for this integration, push that into my private Docker Hub environment. That means my private Docker environment. And then if all this succeeded, that means unit tests are succeeded, image pushes succeeded, then instruct production environment to deploy my Kubernetes artifacts into my production Kubernetes environment. For that, what I am doing is, I have set up the Kubernetes environment in my machine, and so a Jenkins server instruct Kubernetes environment to pull the image from my Docker repository and update the environment. So that's my plan in total CI/CD flow. And also, this integration, what I'm trying to do is, I'm going to develop the integration in Integration Studio and do the push the changes into Git repo. Then I have configured some Git hook trigger. So Git hook trigger, what it will do is, once I commit the changes into Git repo, it will automatically trigger a Jenkins jobs. So for that, I have configured Git hook in my environment. All these things run in my local environment. So you can assume the performance in my environment. Anyway, so in the Git hook also, I have triggered this in locally, but standard Git way, if you have public IP and all, you can trigger to different servers. And because the normal environment, all these servers, all these things are in not a single box. So Integration Studio in your developer box, Jenkins may run in your cloud environment, your Kubernetes, maybe you deploy in Azure Kubernetes service as AKS or AWS, or your own Kubernetes service, maybe a different server. But my case, all are running in my single box. And this case, I have little risk, because I am going to push the customized Docker image to Docker Hub. This is some network consuming task. Let's see how this works. Okay. This is my Jenkins environment. Okay, this is my Jenkins environment. And here I have two CI/CD jobs I have created. First is build and test job. So what this build and test job do is, it will trigger once I check in the source code into a Git repo, but here it is local because I am used run is local, and trigger this event, and then it will run the unit test, Maven test. That this unit test actually developed using WSO2 Enterprise Integrator. I can see one question, actually, you are talking about how this developed. This developed using WSO2 Enterprise Integrator. We are not using any other tool. I'll show how to develop those when I'm doing the demonstration. So here what happened is, first it will run the unit test cases. Once this job is succeeded, then what happened is, it will go to my push images and the Kubernetes deployment solution, and it how it configured is, that job will trigger will trigger after build and test job is stable, because testing, unit testing should have to be stable. If that's stable, then what happened is, it will create the customized Docker image for my development, and then Docker push, it will push to my Docker hub environment. So then my customized Docker image will push to environment. Once those two is succeeded, then I'll instruct my Kubernetes environment to apply changes for new, and then I'm trying to delete it, because then it's automatically update the Kubernetes deployment with new Docker image. So that's my plan. So here you can see I have two jobs in Jenkins. So those two will trigger, should trigger once I do the code changes and push the thing. So now let's go to WSO2 Integration Studio. And Integration Studio, I have a deployer test, the demo Kubernetes demo project, and I have developed a simple Hello World service. So in the Hello World service, so it is, I have just used a payload factory, and I log the message and response it. And this service basically responds, let's assume, earlier it was hello team one, no, whatever, I'll say hello. So this service will respond a message like hello WSO2. That's all. And then you have to write the unit test. So in case of unit test, what I have done is using WSO2 Enterprise Integrator itself, you can write the unit test. So here I have write the hello world test unit test. Actually, in that unit test, what I'm trying to do is I'll try to generate the payload, and then I am trying to compare what I am getting from this API. So I should have to receive the message, hello WSO2. Okay, now I'll update this test case as well. Now this is very simple one, but based on your integration, you can keep on adding some information, like add more test, more integration point, and then you have to do the test. So that's all what I have to do in here. I'll double check my messages and all. If those are vary, then the integration, this whole CI/CD flow will stop with unit testing. So my the API will receive send the message hello WSO2, and my unit test, let's see the message. Yeah, hello WSO2. This should be tally. Otherwise, this whole flow will not run. Now it's ready. Now I have developed it. Or similar way, in your case, you have to develop it using whatever the API you have. Now development part is completed. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to push the changes into my Git repo. So to push the changes, I'll add the things to a repo, and then I'll commit. And it understood like two changes, and I'll push. So now I have pushed the changes. Now, as per my explanation, it should trigger a build automatically. So now let's go to Jenkins server and see whether it's trigger a build automatically. You can see this build and test job. Now it is running. Let's go to inside and see what's happening inside the job. So you can go to console output. So now job is started, and yes, you can see test case here. Sorry, it's here. So test case is passed. That means it compared the message output with my expected output. So that's how you, this is only I have developed one single test case, but here you can see so many the output if you have write so many test cases. Now my build job is completed. Once build job is completed, trigger a new build of push images and Kubernetes deployment. Let's go to again this environment. Now my second job is running in Jenkins. So I'll go to second job, and now it is running. Let's see what happened here. So here actually, since unit test are succeeded, first, it will create the customized Docker image, and then after it will push. Yeah. It will push the changes into my GitHub, Docker private repository. So now pushing part is happening. So this will take some time, around 1 minute. So till that, let's go to my the Docker Hub repository and see if there are any recent pushes. So go to my repositories. Let's try to refresh. Yes, there is a one repository. So this is where I'm going to push. And yes, you can see a few seconds ago, there is a push. So that means this job have to be completed. Yes, now it is completed. That means pushing part is completed. After pushing part is completed, what it will do is it will apply the changes into my Kubernetes environment. So now I am running the Kubernetes here. So you can see my pods and all here. So when I go to pods, you can see the two pods started 25 seconds ago. That means it is my deployment actually. So in the deployment, now two Docker, that means two pods are starting. So let's navigate to pods and see whether it's started properly. You can go to logs. Yes, you can see WSO2 Enterprise Integrator is started inside the pods. So it took 20 seconds, little long time. It's due to my performance and all. And there is another pod as well. Go to second pod and see the logs. Okay, now it started. Now I can consume this, access this data. Earlier I had the message hello team one, but now if it is successfully deployed into a Kubernetes environment, I should get hello WSO2 message. Let's see whether I'm getting the correct message. Okay, I'm getting the correct message. That means hello WSO2, now it is, deployment is completed. Now again, let's go to my Kubernetes and see whether the logs generated. I'm not sure which server it will trigger, because you can see log here in this, because it's run on top of load balancer. So my load maybe goes to different server, and let's try to generate another request and see the output. Sorry. Yes, you can see the logs. So that means the pod will hit the my request. So this how this is actually Kubernetes dashboard. So I'm not going to talk about those. And so this is run in my local environment. But you have in AWS or Azure, you have the proper Kubernetes environment. You can use those as well. And WSO2 provide those artifacts. And even from WSO2 Enterprise Integrator level, you can do. But what I did was even unit test. You can run the unit test from here. Sorry, and run unit test. But this is manual. But in the CI/CD manner, all should have to automate. That's why I use some Jenkins server here. So now this Jenkins server is running, and this Jenkins doer that total CI/CD job. So you can see two jobs. First job run with 33 seconds. Second job run with 1 minute and 19 seconds. This will push the customized Docker image to my Docker Hub. This is my Docker Hub. You can see if this should refresh now. It's sent few second ago. Now it should come, let's assume 1 minute ago, because it took some time. Let's see, 3 minutes ago. So this is a complete story what I want to present today. And now we are ready to answer any question for you guys. And also since you guys have contacted LTI or WSO2, any of your requirements, you can talk to WSO2 team or LTI team. We can support you guys. So can we see any questions? Okay, it's answered. What to WSO2 unit testing? Yeah, unit testing WSO2 use, I think Natasha explained that. For unit testing, WSO2 use Enterprise Integrator built-in tool. And you can refer the documentation link what Natasha shared, and that will provide how you can configure unit testing. And then you can automate. Even this automation, all step provide available in WSO2 documentation. You can refer documentation and you can go to there. Yes, source code and artifacts, actually, yes, we can share the demo recording and all. And also you can refer the documentation. Go to WSO2 Enterprise Integrated Documentation, search CI/CD, and then the whole bunch of things what I did, was there. But what I did was like just compile it together. File with size of 5 GB. This approach will fail. How we handle the big pile? Yes. Yes, I think Natasha explained that as well. So in big pile cases, if it is too large, we have a streaming integrator. Because streaming integrator mainly support for this type of streaming solution. So they are even a streaming integrator can divide that big pile in a different chunk and process it. And a streaming integrator actually process it in real time. You know, like WSO2 streaming integrator situation, mainly Uber. Uber use WSO2 streaming integrator for real-time data processing. All the Uber booking process via WSO2 streaming integrator. So that support for large file size zone and all. So can we use Sun at asset, which is which base image is being used while creating the image. So WSO2 enterprise integrator, the base image we use, and then after it create the customized image. So WSO2 base Docker image, you can report WSO documentation and you can get the base image. And then I integrate that to my basic integration to that image. And also what you can do is even you should not want to know, don't want to know those things. You can download WSO2 Integration Studio and you can go to a getting start guide. It's here. And then you can go to, sorry, my screen is not shared. No? Wait, I'll share my screen again. So in Integration Studio, you can go to help, you can go to help and you can go to getting start. And then you can see all these samples. So here, so unit test. If you want to run the unit test tutorial, you can start with here. And wait, see the Kubernetes deployment. Yeah, it is Docker and Kubernetes. Yeah, Hello Kubernetes. So you can start with this Hello Kubernetes service. Then automatically it will create the it will direct to a base image and even it will create the deployment YAML file and all. And you can use those and continue. Even this project, you can see all those available. Wait, I'll show in this project. Yes, here actually, this is the project. This is composite. Here all our deployment integration CRML. So here, this is a base image, you can see. And this base image, all you no need to know all those paths. Once we started the demo Kubernetes project, it will automatically configured with the latest images and all. So you can start with this. Only thing is you should have the running environment and then you should have a integration studio ready. Then all those sample, you no need to create all those. All those will create in the sample itself. Here, getting a start guide, start from this point. So you can do most of the cases from here, even unit testing and all. Okay, let's see any other questions. Yes, WSO2 support for IPaaS model. Actually, it is the future for WSO2 and we support for IPaaS. And even now beta is ready, but it's still not open for you guys. Most probably another 1 to 2 months time, you will receive the IPaaS, WSO2 IPaaS called Corio. Corio is ready and you can use it for IPaaS type solution. It's available. And the Kubernetes deployment show micro integrator. Yes, Kubernetes deployment use micro integrator because the earlier we had the ESB. The difference is ESP and micro integrator is micro integrator full cloud native. It's you can see the 5 to 6 second startup time and all. And Kubernetes deployment actually use WSO2 micro integrator. That's embedded. is then message encryption using RSA in WSO2. Yes, we have a message encryption support, and also WSO2 will support type of concept called class mediators. Using class mediators, what you can do is you can plug your encryption code and all to class mediator, and then you can do a message encryption decryption, and then you can use whatever the encryption decryption algorithm you need, and you can plug it. So that's the recommended way. What is the main difference between WSO2EI 6.5 and micro integrator 7.1? Yes, I think I explained. 6.5 is the ESB trial. So in that case, it took around 1 minute to start up. So it's not that much ready for the cloud native deployment. But micro integrator is full ready for cloud native deployment. So any more question? Wait. I have a client who is struggling with integration. They are brownfield system, but won't turn to leverage open source system so that they have control on integration build. Yes, you can use things in open source manner, and you can use it, and no restriction from WSO2. And if you need the support, you can contact people like LTO WSO2. It's optional. We are not imposing our clients to use the paid subscription for WSO2. You can use open source version, no problem. Which tool WSO use for code quality check? No. Actually, we don't have any tool for code quality check and all. And okay. WSO2 integrator is total open source, so is it paid version is available? In case of WSO2, it's not like open source version or paid version. If you just download the source code from WSO2 repository, it is open source, and paid version also the same product. That means feature wise no difference, but different in the subscription product is it's provide the WSO2 support for you guys for any production issues, and then we provide the security patches for you guys and your production support, 24/7 driven support and bug fixes, security patches. Those fees are the value addition for subscription paying clients. Or you can use open source version, feature wise no difference, but only thing is then any issue or whatever, you have to wait till a WSO release next version, maybe a 3 to 6 months. Because production type of system, we are not recommended that approach. But if you are willing to take that challenge to maintain system, then you can use open source version, no problem. And even you can repo the source code and you can fix the whatever issue you have, that's okay. But subscription is mainly, it's a dedicated service provided from us for you to run your business. And especially production deployment, we recommend to use subscription, but decision is up to you. And okay, there are so many questions. Where does WS store request response log? Is it keep log file or DB? Actually, it is keep in the log file, not in the DB. But if you need, you can transfer those to DB as well. But in the standard way, it is keep in the log file. I have large number of code. Sorry, can someone answer my the focus was. I have large number of code. Okay, I'll explain the question. I have large number of code produced using earlier studio. What is the right way to import and use the same code at later studio? So Ripper WSO2 studio documentation, it will guide you to import the project. So install a new project and then import from your old repository to new repository, then it will work. Ripper the documentation in WSO2 documentation, check how to import the old version, new, those documentation there, and then follow the documentation path, and then you can do that task. Is this available as a community edition? So as I told early, no difference, no community edition or whatever, same version, the support is differentiated. This is available for community, and you can go to our website and you can see it. No difference, no two version like other product, or like a basis open source and additional features. Our model is not like that. We are fully open source. Things available, you can get it and you can use it. How can we access the shared Windows folder from EI proxy service? Yes, if you are running the Linux and all, then that should available for Linux platform. But if we are running on Windows environment, very easily you can share and access the file. And if not, you can just create some job to copy that to your Linux server or whatever. And then you can pick the file from that folder and you can run the job. Or otherwise, you have to mount it to a Linux file system. Then as a local file, you can pick the file. What is the best way to inject parameterized endpoint? Depend on different environment. I have UAT test for then different parameters. Yes. In that case, there are like different approach. One is those parameterized endpoints you can configure in your environment deployment level. So let's assume UAT environment, you can keep those parameters. And then you can parameterize that in the integration flow. And then when integration is running, it will pick the file from configuration file. And that configuration file is different from UAT to test to live. That's the one approach. Another approach is, when the environment start, we can pass even those parameters to your code environment. So that's the second approach. But I think first approach may be easy. You can keep local configuration file for environment to environment, and then your integration can refer those. Is there any performance measurement criteria tools to test in EI? Yes, mainly we use JMeter as a performance testing tool, and also performance benchmark results readily available, and you can get those performance results as well, and you can use JMeter and you can automate because end of the day those are set of APIs. We are using normally JMeter since the pre, and you can use same version and run your unit testing. And performance test results anyway available freely with WSO2. You can search WSO2 Enterprise Integrator Performance Benchmark and Test Results. You will get the DOS documentation. Yes, I think your question, how can I access the Windows shared folder from EI proxy using Docker deployed EI profile? So in case of Docker deploy EI profile, then you have to mount that point, that Windows file to Docker repository, and then you can refer it. But thing is, in case of Docker, people, most of the time, people talk about immutable deployment. So in that case, little doubtful, but the thing is you have to mount that point to a Docker from Windows to Docker mount, you have to search because there are different texting for do to mount those. Once you mount into a Docker, then you can access that file and run the deployment. Okay, I think I have answered almost all the question. Is the Berna replace sequence in future? Is Berna replace sequence in future? Yes, Berna will replace little bit because what I chose is Synapse. So Synapse sequence running, but Ballerina also similar concept will run in. And also Ballerina will provide like similar experience with new platform. Actually it come as a Corio, it's a iPaaS platform. There you can drag and drop manner again, like this studio, you can integrate even Ballerina system. And then similar way, it will generate the Ballerina source code once you did the drag and drop deployment. And also if you change from source code, it will generate the your visual drawing as well. So that means like this, it is a two-way communicatable deployment in the Corio platform. So this mediation concept little vary, but similar experience, low code environment, drag and drop, all those features available in our Corio platform. But Corio platform is running, integration running, with WSO2 Berna runtime. That's the difference.
Okay, thank you so much, Rohita and Anandya, for speaking today. And thank you, everyone, for joining our meetup.